Welcome back to After the Fact. The battle for the 2022 elections is not just about candidates running for the same positions. There's also the battle between facts and falsehoods waged within the bigger disinformation war. Here, historians play a crucial role, not just journalists who appear to carry the heavy burden of fighting disinformation against untrained content creators doing propaganda work. But like journalists, historians are also assailed, heavily criticized if they talk politics and try to set the record straight about outright lies and disinformation propagated during the election. Detractors insist they should be neutral in an election campaign because supposedly history is neutral. We're now joined by historian Professor Michael Charleston Shao Chua. He's a professor of history at De La Salle University. Good evening, Professor, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Makasaysayang gabi, Christian, at sa lahat ng ating kapamilya. It's an honor.
Okay, let's try to make this segment or this interview more educational and informative. Basically, I'd like to start with, is there a role for historians like you in an election campaign, given what is at stake, in particular, the 2022 elections?
Well, first of all, I would like to talk about Christian. The supposed or the assumed position of historians in politics, before I can answer your question. And of course, the assumed position was that since history is evidence-based and it should be, shall we say, positivist, evidence-based based on documents and all of that, there's an assertion that historians should be objective. That it should not take sides. And the way that history has been recorded or written by historians during the earlier times was that they seem neutral. They just echo what's in the documentation and say it as it is. Now, of course, eventually what happened was, as human beings, and Teodoro Gonzalo, the greatest Filipino historian, said that we are human beings. We had backgrounds. We're part of a culture. Therefore, these contexts of our lives and our culture actually animate our views, even the way we tell our story, despite the fact that we are supposedly objective. So that's why Teodoro Gonzalo is saying that that historians cannot be totally objective about the past. And anyways, that is true because anyway, history, there will always be politics. How can you divorce a historian to politics when history in itself is politics?
Okay.
So basically, that is the assumed position. And we now clarify it that yes, historians have certain positions. We can actually take a stand because, you know, if you do not take a stand today, if you're a historian, after looking at all the evidence, it would seem that you are not a historian. You're just telling a story. You should be able to analyze these things, in particular, the politics.
So the basic idea that history or historians should be neutral, you think it's a misnomer?
Yes, it is a misnomer, but I have to make a point here, that it doesn't mean that we should be totally partisan. What does that mean? Historians should have a stand, yes. Historians can have a political stand because as a Filipino citizen, historians also have a right to participate in politics as provided for in the 1987 Constitution, since today is what we call the Constitution Day. Yet, what I can say is this. The objectivity of a historian can be now explained as, yes, we can have a stand, but we should be fair. That's clear. We should have a stand, but we should be fair.
Okay. Let's focus on certain definitions. So on a definition of term, very important, objectivity. You mentioned that. Mm-hmm. What exactly does objectivity mean in the context of historiography, for instance? Because, for example, in journalism, if you talk about objectivity, it's not the same as fairness and balance. It has to do with an objective process, a set of standards that journalists are supposed to follow in terms of verifying and investigating information that they get before they serve that to the public. Is that similar to how historians like you do your task? The objective process of arriving at the truth based on evidence, based on documents.
It's good that you clarified how journalists actually do your job in terms of objectivity, because there is a, shall we say, there is an assumption that the definition of objectivity in science, which is basically that, you know, you're just making the data flow and all of that, and it's always like that. 1 + 1 = 2. That's objectivity. But also, objectivity in science is also based on a methodology. What you explained is the journalist methodology. We also have what we call historical methodology. Mm-hmm. Now, that means that we can analyze and make a stand as long as we already subjected all of this. Meaning, if I want to learn about something and make a stand about it, I cannot just make a stand based on what I believe. Okay? I should always look at the data presented, meaning if there are many perspectives, many witnesses, and then you put them all together, and then you decide what is the truth based on the evidence. That's why I'm saying, yes, I can make a stand, but be fair, listen to the other side. Listen also to those the other voices, and be fair to them. Meaning, even if you did not agree with them, you will not misrepresent their stand. Meaning, okay, if I make a stand, I will not lie for the people who believe with me. I will not lie against the people who do not believe with me.
Basically, it's a stand based on evidence or critical examination or analysis of data.
Yes, sir.
Gathered. Oh, preferably first-hand information, no? And then secondary, yes, or third-hand or fourth-hand, and so on and so forth, sources. Mm-hmm. I-apply natin to pinag-uusapan natin in specific issues related to the election.
Yes.
I noticed that you have been very, very active on your social media accounts, TikTok, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, trying to correct certain misinformation or disinformation that we're seeing over the past several months. What do you think are the most pressing, most urgent issues related to disinformation in this election campaign that should be addressed by historians like yourself?
Well, first of all, we have to set the context. First, we're talking about the past. Now, we're talking about the past, especially what happened about 50 years ago, because today is 2022. 1972 was when martial law was proclaimed. We have to bring it up because people are actually dragging the past along with them. You know, meaning because of political gain, people have to misrepresent. Some sectors have to misrepresent what happened 50 years ago during the time of the President Marcos. So that's why we have to emphasize that we have to look at how that era in our history is being presented now. So for example, we all know that there is an issue about the plunder that happened during the Marcos regime, the $10 billion loot, not just of Marcos, but also of the cronies and a lot of the people in the system, in the authoritarian system. So, ano ngayon yung sinasagot? How do they answer that now? Now, of course, not officially, but ever since about maybe 10 to 20 years ago, they've been telling these stories, false narratives about how the Marcos has acquired that many wealth. Mm-hmm. And I think we addressed it in one of our podcasts, Christian,
Italiano
about
gold.
The Italiano gold.
Quote unquote, Italiano gold,
the Yamashita gold. Now, of course, we historians, at first when we are asked about it, we do not want to go public, because historians, if we answer something, it has to be, you know, something that is an important issue. And we did not think that this was important because it's based on a baloney. But of course, what happened was a lot of people already believe this. It's being used by some in the campaign albeit not officially, and they deny it officially now that they know about this, but people use it for political gain to answer the allegations of corruption. Now, of course, these are the fantastic claims. There are also some of the claims that are, although truthful, might be selective. So, for example, if you look at the Marcos record of infrastructures, of what they did, of their initiatives, then you can say that, in a way, that is true. That is what happened. They had initiatives. But to misrepresent it as the golden age, because it was not, although there was a time that our economy actually went up after martial law was proclaimed, it actually went down because of mismanagement in the 1980s. So and of course of the foreign debt that we accumulated. So what's happening is that they are presenting only the sunshine bits and not the dark bits. Now, of course, okay, for example, let me be clear about this. I am critical of the Marcoses, and people know this. I've been studying the human rights violations since I was in high school and continued on and actually became a more committed scholar because of that, meaning I actually fought with them in the streets, for example. But that doesn't mean that I will lie for my supporters to say that the Marcoses did not do anything good. In fact, my master's thesis is about Imelda Marcos's governance of Metro Manila when she was governor of Metro Manila and first lady. And despite the fact of that I was critical a lot of times, I also appreciated some of the initiatives that she took. So that is how we historians should discuss this. We cannot lie for the people that we support.
But this half-truths, misinformation, and disinformation about the Marcoses or in favor of the Marcoses, how important is it for historians like you to correct these?
It is important. Why? Because we always teach this in our history classes, to tell people, why is my subject important? Why, you know, you're going to my class about and we will talk about the past, and people will just say, you know, it's the past. I mean, what's so important about it? Now, of course, the thing that we say here is that yes, there are two main uses of the past. Number one, if we know our past, we can know ourselves. So it builds Filipino identity. We should have correct narratives, or at least proper narratives in the Filipino perspective that gives credence to Filipino point of view, so that we can face the world and have a Filipino identity. Now, the second use of history for me is to learn the lessons of history. Of course, you've heard this a lot of times. Jorge Santayana, the Spanish philosopher, said, "Those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it." This means that if we do not learn the lessons of the past, meaning if we do not correct the wrongdoings, if we do not, for example, address the crimes committed before, and we do not make them pay, at least by people remembering what happened, then we are doomed to repeat it again. Okay. And we will allow these things again.
How would you respond to this specific question? I think this also raised in your social media posts or YouTube videos, no? May mga Marcos loyalists doon na nagsasabi, pero bakit si Marcos lang ang kinokorrect nyo? Bakit siya ang focus ng campaign nyo against disinformation? Can't you move on?
Oh, because you cannot also move on. Because you try to repeat the false narratives about him. That's why we have to answer them always. Now, of course, in all fairness to all of us historians, we've been talking about presidents. I think I participated in one series about the presidencies, a whole series of shows about the presidents, and a lot of historians did as well. But of course, the problem is, wala namang Quirinong tumatakbo. Wala namang Laurel na tumatakbo. Diba?
To add to that, Shao, yung ano, among the presidential candidates now, sino ba yung anak ng dating diktador? Na yung tatay ng diktador ng martial law. And who was in power for 20 years.
So, and in fact, Christian, The problem is, hindi naman yung tatay ang tumatakbo. Bakit siya yung, kasi ngayon na nga, dahil di ba, eh, dapat yung anak ang pag-usapan natin, bakit yung tatay pa din?
Okay.
Oh, yun ang problem dyan.
Let's talk about the difficulties encountered by historians like you. Ikaw mismo in particular, yung experience mo in trying to correct outright disinformation, conspiracy theories being propagated in social media. For example, yung Taliano Gold. I've seen your posts, very effective, di ba? Based on likes and views. Pero pag tinignan mo yung mga posts, nanganak na yan, di ba? Yung Taliano Gold issue na yan, di mo na nga alam kung ano yung pinanggalingan niyan. That's one thing very miserable with lies, no? Hindi mo kailangan alamin kung ano yung pinanggalingan at kung ano yung talaga yung original version, because any version can be acceptable to a lot of people. How difficult is it for you as a historian to correct those disinformation on social media?
Well, it's difficult now, Christian, kasi before, we can go to the media to say, and it will go widespread because there was only the tri-media, that these things are wrong. That there are historical assertions that we should correct. And then, of course, we have the textbooks, which are not saying, you know, they're not bad. That the textbook now are not bad. Except that it's not the sole, we the media and the schools are not the sole sources of information now. The more major sources of information are at the cell phone of your kid. That's why it has to be said that despite the fact of the many efforts of Filipino historians, not just myself, but a lot of Filipino historians to correct these things, nasa sidestep kami ng algorithms of Facebook, of other social media. So because we do not have the money, hindi naman kami gagastos pa. We will just say the truth, but we do not have money to spread that truth and pay for algorithms and all of that, which a lot of these PR groups of the politicians have. And so that's why there's difficulty.
What would be a good institutional approach to this? Assuming that, kasi ito yung problema, di ba? Let's say the son of the former president wins the presidential election. Mm-hmm. What would happen to the issue, the problem of, you raised this also in previous interviews, the textbooks that we have now, they show very little about martial law as far as the truth about martial law is concerned. Mm-hmm. So institutionally, what should be and what should have been the approach? Let's say by the Department of Education or in dati, yung DEXPA.
Well, first of all, we should have more history in our classes in the K-12. Now, the problem is, you remember that in the Sibikat Kultura and the Araling Panlipunan before, there are many grades when history is being talked about. No? Kasi may grade 5 Philippine history, di ba? May grade 6 na medyo government naman. And then first year, Philippine history again, pero mas malalim. And then you have first year college na Philippine history din, na iba rin naman yung approach, mas malalim pa rin. But today, remember that Philippine history has been removed from high school. So sa elementary na lang siya dinidiscuss. Now, how can you discuss that in a deeper manner to grade 6 people, plunder? You can discuss it, pero hindi mo siya mapapalalim. Na pwede mo sanang palalimin if you have a Philippine history in high school. So I still campaign and join my friends in the Philippine High School Philippine History Movement to bring back Philippine history in high school for the K-12. We need more of that. No, that's the institutional solution. And also, they're trying their best, of course, the National Historical Commission of the Philippines, to be more proactive in saying this, in correcting these things. But of course, we also have the problem of human rights, you see, Christian, because everyone has the freedom of speech. That's why we allow the lies are allowed, and of course we can answer them. Pero yun na nga, they have the money to spread this misinformation.
Okay, Professor Shao Chua, thank you for joining us tonight on the program.